Tepe bulgularının arkeoloji ve mimarlık tarihi açısından önemini anlatmak üzere Kazı Başkanı Sayın Profesör Klaus Schmidt'i sahneye davet ediyorum.
Ladies and gentlemen, at first I would like to thank Aarhus Bay and the Architects Association for this kind invitation to come here to Istanbul to give a report about the Göbekli project. And I also would like to say many thanks to Dr. Ahmet Fakih Baba, who came for this lecture and who made this kind introduction. The site of Göbekli Tepe is really an unusual site in several aspects. At first, the topographical setting, which you can recognize already on this first slide. It's on top of a huge limestone plateau, is a landmark visible from far away. That's one aspect. Usually prehistoric sites are not on top of mountains, they are in the valleys, they are on slopes. So a quite unusual setting. The second is the size of the site. All what you see here on earthen mound is not a natural mound, it's an artificial mound, it's a tell, a tepe, but in the sense of an artificial mound. And another very important and astonishing aspect is the dating of this mound, which is completely belonging to the 10th and 9th millennium BC. The time when pottery, for example, important for many archaeological cultures which are dated later, pottery was not invented, and also the farming, village farming life was not invented. The people still had been hunter-gatherers, like all the periods, all the hundreds of thousands of years of the old Stone Age. The people in Göbekli Tepe still had been hunter-gatherers, but belonging to a society of hunter-gatherers who are now, by the way, who are inventing now this new way of life, the village farming way of life, which is the base of all our modern civilizations. For this, we need a little more global view to these events which are happening in the area of the fertile crests and of the Near East. Here on this map, in red, are indicated all the regions in the world where this transition from hunter-gatherers to farmers is taking place independently from each other. So the invention of this farming way of life, and the numbers, of course, are the dates before BC, before Christ, and we recognize that the Near East is the region in the world where this transition happens first time, much earlier than in any other regions, and also this time for the Far East, for China 7000, is still a question mark if it was so early or maybe a little bit earlier. But it's clear in this region we have a development which is important for all the historical events in the old world. I indicated here by this oval, as there is no other region in the old world where this transition happened a second time, because this transition was so important for the cultures of the Mediterranean and for Europe and for North Africa and for the Middle East, that it was, that had been under the influence of this neolithization of an Eastern type, which we call it in scientific terms. Neolithization means that the cultures now are getting food producing, they are food producers and not anymore hunter-gatherers as before. Here the development in Europe is indicated so several times. So Britain is reached at least in the third millennium, and not with colors indicated as the development in Middle Asia and North Africa, but we could continue here in a similar way as this map had been done for the Mediterranean region. So we recognize here an area being the core area where all these events are coming from, the so-called fertile crests, and a term coined by Henry Bristed, an Egyptologist, 100 years ago. Here, this fertile crest is indicated a little bit in a better way, and we recognize southeastern Turkey is part of this fertile crest in a region we call maybe best Upper Mesopotamia, because part of North Syria and parts of northern Iraq are included. In this Upper Mesopotamian region, we know now these main events are happening happening that are taking place not in the western wing of the fertile crescent. For a long time the research had been dominated by research done in this area, because in Jericho English colleague Kathleen Kenyon first time was discovering this culture of the pre-pottery Neolithic, which she coined this term, and she divided it in two steps of PPN, pre-pottery Neolithic, PPN A and PPN B, the younger one. But this is now history of research. Now we recognize that these pre-pottery Neolithic cultures are also existing in the north, and here we have we are sure now we have the dominant region where the main events are happening. It's not a surprise. We knew it also from natural history researches that this region is so important. For example, here a map done by paleobotanists mapping the distribution of several plants, of the wild species of plants, which later had been domesticated. So, and we recognize there is a common area of all these distribution areas, a common area where all these plants are existing, and this is exactly the region we are now dealing with. The number three is Göbekli Tepe, so it's in the center of this distribution maps of wild species which later had been domesticated. So we will see now in my lecture that this natural habitat, that these ecological conditions and the results of the archaeological work are fitting very, very well together and giving us an important historical picture which is really quite new, which was not known 10, 20 years, maybe 20 years ago. But events being a little bit predicted by colleagues like Khaled Jambal from Istanbul University and Robert Braidwood from Chicago University, which did a survey in southeastern Turkey for the first time, a survey in 63, now 50 years ago. And they predicted this region will be the core area when you are looking for sites of this transition from hunter-gatherers to farming societies, and they listed a lot of sites in their survey, and Göbekli Tepe was included. But in this time was not ripe, time was not ready to recognize the importance of this mound, which had been not recognized being an artificial mound in this time. But they listed the site, and so it was for me the chance to when I was checking several of these sites, to recognize now with a fresh knowledge and background of excavations done in the meantime, to understand the importance, the high importance of this site. Fortunately, we have such air photos from 95, the first year of our season, and you can recognize that nothing was visible, just fields on these earthen mounds. But for specialists, the flint tools really are telling stories about the time, about the dating, about the setting of this site. And so it was very easily, with the new results by a lot of excavations done in this region, to understand the dating and the meaning, the importance of this mound, of this artificial mound on top of this limestone plateau. You can recognize here a little bit better the landmark position of this site. And in 96 we started, in 95 we did a survey around just to recognize the site. In 96 we started with large-scale excavations, and we added some other areas in the later years. We will see some details of this, of the results of these excavations. But the main area is the area where we started in 96. It's a southern slope, and here now a situation already some years ago, I think it was 2009, as a main excavation area, and you recognize here several installations which are quite monumental installations, dominated by these pillars, monolithic pillars made up from limestone, always with this typical T shape, we will come to this point later, arranged in circles or in ovals, and always there are two very big ones in the center of these enclosures, of these installations. They are numbered in order of their discovery, A, B, they are not visible here because under a temporary roof, and C and D, four monumental enclosures under work for the moment. It's a southern slope. Yeah, more sensitive photo from enclosure D, the largest one and the best preserved one so far. As I told you, always two freestanding in the center, surrounded by a circle or an oval of similar but always smaller T-shaped pillars. We don't know a lot of things. There are still a lot of miracles around the site of Göbekli Tepe, but fortunately one thing is quite clear. It's a symbolic meaning of these strange T-shapes which are dominating the site, T-shapes which had first been discovered in Nevali Chori. This was the site which opened this new phase of research in the area, an excavation done by Harald Hauptmann from Heidelberg University, and I was team member in all the seasons. And in Nevali Chori, first time such T-shapes had been discovered, not in the monumental shape like in Göbekli Tepe, but the same symbolic meaning, and we clearly can understand the meaning by the arms and the fingers depicted in flat relief, that the meaning is that of a human-like being, highly stylized, but human-like beings. Important, never a face is depicted, always faceless. This is very important. It looks like that they are not from our world, they are coming from another world, but they are arranged in such installations in the Nevali Chori, not circular or oval, but nearly rectangular. And here I made a reconstruction. It was a destruction happened here in old times, but this would be the appearance when you have the pillars reconstructed. So in Nevali Chori, we first time we discovered this culture, which now in Göbekli Tepe have in a monumental scale. So we recognize it's a network of sites, of settlements. Nevali Chori is a settlement of the 10th and 9th millennium, but Göbekli Tepe is now different. It's not a settlement, it's completely a sanctuary, a ritual site in a monumental way. Here in green, the circles A, B, C, D, which we saw already in the photo before, we have some younger layer of the 9th millennium, where the T-shapes still are existing. The elements in red are the pillars, the monumental ones in the green layer, and small ones in the yellow layer. So in the 9th millennium, a clear reduction is visible till zero. Around 8,200, the site is completely abandoned, and we have a very good hypothesis, I think, so for this abandonment. Now the transition from hunter-gatherers to farmers happened. It took place. Now the people had been farming, village farming people, and the old world of the hunter-gatherers, the spiritual world of the hunter-gatherers, was not anymore important, and the site of Göbekli Tepe had been completely abandoned. Yeah, here, just to show you, this is a schematical map, so, but in the background we have also very detailed architectural documentation for all the things we are excavating, and here some attempt of a reconstruction of these circles. It's still an open question if they are with this roof, like here in reconstruction done by one of our architects, or if they had been open areas. It's still unsolved, not completely clear, but clear is a general layout which always has these two central pillars surrounded by other ones, which is showing a layout like a gathering of a group of these T-shapes, of these T-shaped beings, a gathering of them around two in the center who are more important than the other ones. Yeah, we had some, we have a lot of detailed studies, for example, in building research. There is a study ready to be published by Dietmar Korabkat, and there is actual work done by Katja Pieske, and we also have laser scan documentation, terrestrial laser scan and object laser scan by Erwin Cristofori and colleagues who are documenting the architectural remains of the site. And we have a lot of other detailed studies, like a study for the water supply, because we don't have springs at the site. There is the springs are 5 meters, the next springs are 5 kilometers away, but now we have some good results for these bedrock constructions, which are cisterns. So we found out here the drainage system of the site where the rainwater is flowing down, and especially here in this part we have a lot of water running down. We have this cistern system, so a lot of detailed studies about the site, which was not a settlement but a sanctuary, but people living all over the year at the sanctuary. It's looking like that specialists beings there working in the quarries to produce mainly to produce these monumental monolithic pillars, these T-shaped pillars, which are this most characteristic element of the site here. One of these T-shapes, one of the central pillar of enclosure B, and the pillars very often have and decoration, mainly animals are depicted there, but also other motifs. So they are really a very impressive element of this of Göbekli Tepe. And when we are looking for comparisons, it's hard to find something similar to these T-shapes. We know it only from so far from Upper Mesopotamia, from this 10th and 9th millennium. A little bit similar phenomenon maybe are the Taulas from Menorca island, but these Taulas are Iron Age, they are first millennium, and they are always made from two stones, one stone on top and the shaft separate, but in contrary, the Göbekli Tepe stones always are monolithic, they are made from one stone, so it's just a similarity, a very rough similarity, but no real genetical connection between these two elements, and as I told you, these are 7,000 to 8,000 years younger. So the T-shapes are very exciting element because of the decorations, which not only one or two animals, it exists like this, but in many cases we have really several motifs together which make clear it's not just decoration, it's more an illustration of some stories which are here told to us. We are in a time long before the invention of writing, so we don't have any further help for the understanding of these motifs, of these meanings. So we cannot look to written sources. Writing is invented 3000 BC, we are here 9000 BC. So, but the arrangement and the motifs, they are showing us some mythological stories which are told here and which are not always so peacefully. We have very often, we have scorpions, we have snakes, we have vultures and other animals, and we have here, for example, a headless person. You recognize the shoulder, the arm, and the other arm, but no head, and so on. So it's looking like these reliefs are telling us mythological stories which are depicted on the pillars. And especially this motif here on this pillar is reminding us a little bit another site which will be also included in this series of lectures. Jan Hotter, I saw, will be here in summer speaking about Çatalhöyük, a site on central Anatolia, very famous, known since now 50 years, due to the excavations done by James Mellard, and now the second phase of excavations under direction of Jan Hotter. Çatalhöyük, 2,000 years younger than Göbekli Tepe, but still there seems to be the spiritual world of Göbekli Tepe still seems to be alive. For example, this well-known fresco with vultures and headless person is clearly reminding this pillar from Göbekli Tepe. Çatalhöyük being part of the spiritual world of Göbekli Tepe, but a late phenomenon in comparison to the much older side of Göbekli Tepe. Just, I don't show you all the reliefs, but it would be not possible in this evening, but just some selected examples here. Another one with a very rich decoration, crane-like birds, snakes are visible here, some symbols which very often are repeated. We don't know the meaning of it, but they seem to be very important here. Another symbol like this, an insect, snakes, and here a spider, and so on, full with reliefs telling mythological stories as far as we can understand the meaning of these pieces. So the pillars are the most important architectural element of these circles. Another element are such monolithic stones, which are looking like a basin, but it's not a basin. You can go through. It's like a window, like a frame of a window of a door. So we preliminarily call it porthole stones. This one is in situ position in enclosure B. We saw already this pillar with a fox. Here we have the floor of the enclosure, a quite small one. So, and our idea is maybe it had been placed in the wall in a vertical position, giving the entrance to the enclosure. We had a surprise in the last campaign, continuing work on the northwestern part of the mound. It was an area we started in 2009. We knew from geomagnetic and ground penetrating radar research that we don't have the circles not only in the excavation area. Here you recognize the schematical map again, but they are all over the site existing such circles. For example, enclosure D is depicted here. It's quite small in comparison to other ones which are not excavated but which are visible here in this map of ground penetrating radar. So we opened a new area of excavations in the north western part. Here's a group doing the geo radar, and as expected, we found some part of this younger layer of the 9th millennium. We found already monumental pillars of big circles which are hidden here under in the earth. But one surprise was this part here in one trench. At first, no further context, just below the surface, an element which was really astonishing here again to remember the piece from enclosure B and the idea how we suppose that the use had been like portal stones of megalithic tombs of Western Europe, but now we found in this trench a piece with two entrances beside each other. So it was a very surprise. We didn't have any idea. We don't have any idea why you need two entrances beside each other, and also high reliefs of animals placed on the rim of this portal stone, animals which are looking like guards guarding the entrance to the structure which had been originally behind the stone, which is without further context for the moment, but hopefully when we can continue here in the trench, we will find a context maybe similar to enclosure B, as we had been excavated several years ago. But back to the T-shapes, the main element here, again a photo of enclosure D, now looking down, looking to southeast, down to the valley, the Haran plain, which is on the foot of the site, and which is giving us again an idea about this landmark position of the site, so really visible from far away from all directions. And one reason why the site had been placed on this mountain clearly is a position here looking down to the plain. The Haran plain can be understood being the beginning of Mesopotamia, of true Mesopotamia, and the mountainous region behind Göbekli Tepe is the beginning of Anatolia. So there's the border between Anatolia and Mesopotamia, exactly in this point on this mountain, the site of Göbekli Tepe had been placed. Why we are able to excavate all these installations which are in situ? We didn't change anything. It's an in situ situation we are unveiling, we are uncovering here. It's due to a phenomenon that all these sanctuaries had been completely backfilled already in Neolithic times. This is part of the This is part of the original backfill material which we are excavating. There are many hundreds of cubic meters we have to remove from these enclosures to excavate them. And this backfill in Neolithic times, it's giving us this perfect preservation of all these installations and the pillars. You can recognize here one example with an arm, like the Nevelichori example, and here a fox, the relief of a fox is included. It's like this T-shaped being is holding a fox in its right arm. This backfilling material is not sterile. It's full with artifacts, mainly chipped stone debris, limestone flakes, animal bones. Some human bones are also included, and other artifacts which can be expected in a site of this dating. Just an example of some of the flint tools, some arrowheads which are giving us a good base for archaeological dating of the site. Besides the radiocarbon dates we have for the dating, we can also do archaeological dating by typology, especially of flint tools, just to have an idea about this material. And the animal bones, which are very, very rich, give us an idea about the fauna, about the surrounding landscape, a fauna, an archaeofauna dominated by gazelle, followed by wild cattle and by wild ass, foxes, wild pig, wild sheep and goat. So again, no domesticated animals. As I told you, these people in Göbekli Tepe or are coming to Göbekli Tepe, they are now inventing the domestication, but they are still hunter-gatherers. So we don't have any domesticated species included, and the same would be with a botany, with an archaeobotanical find studied by another group on the Rhine and Neve, the zoologist from guided by Angela von den Riesch, and some genetical research also as are underway by directed by Manfred Hoyn from Oslo University. But back to the architecture, we are here talking mainly about architecture. I just want to give you a frame where this architecture is set in. Most typical, these circular arrangements with two central pillars in the middle here, enclosure C. Unfortunately, in this enclosure, we had a very heavy destruction in antiquity. Like in Nevali Chori, you remember one of the first slides, the pillars had been destroyed, just the lower parts had been preserved. A similar phenomenon here, the central pillars had been destroyed in antiquity. But fortunately, most of the pillars of the circle are preserved completely, a little bit out of order, these two ones, but the other ones are still in order. And here we even have a second circle of walls and pillars around this arrangement, but the general layout is similar like in enclosure D. And here we reached, some years ago, we reached the floor being the natural bedrock, artificially smoothed, very carefully smoothed, and out of the bedrock two pedestals had been cut out of it, giving the place for the central pillars, which are in the middle of these bedrock pedestals, which are cut out of the natural limestone. Yeah, here this destruction was very heavy. Usually we don't change something, but you can recognize this pillar, this pillar shaft broken in two pieces. We couldn't remove this block of sediments when we wouldn't change it. So here we made an exception. So we did some kind of re-erection of these two pillar elements, a work where no big machines could be used because the excavation area is very large and we couldn't come near to it. So we had to use methods maybe a little bit similar to the methods the Stone Age people already had been using for such work. And so we had been successfully to re-erect, to join and to re-erect these two pieces of the pillar shaft, which are here still in the original position here under work. And now here's a result, the successfully re-erection of the lower part of this pillar. And we also did a laser scan of all the fragments which had been found in the backfilling, and it was a little surprise that all these fragments are belonging to pillar 35. Also, the pillars are numbered in order of their discovery, so the numbers are not always 1, 2, 3, 4, but quite high numbers. And so all these fragments are belonging to pillar 35, and the upper part of pillar 37 still is not discovered so far. But we did a laser scanning of the fragments and the pillars, as I told you, here an idea about the appearance now of pillar 37, where a fox relief has been getting visible after the re-erection, and some other pillar of the circle where we have not only a flat relief but a high relief, like high reliefs we already had been seen on this porthole stone. And here some work of the laser scanning, the three-dimensional scanning, and we could virtually join all these fragments found in the filling material, join it to pillar 35, and we are getting a height of exactly 5 meters above the bedrock pedestal. So 5 meters, this is really monumental. This is not a miniature, this is a monumental installation. Just for comparison, Stonehenge, the trilits of Stonehenge are between 5 and 6 meters in height. So we have a similar dimension here with the monuments of Göbekli Tepe. This was a work in enclosure C, which is continued now in details by documenting the walls and the pillars there, but the engineering work is at its end for the moment in this enclosure. But it had been done, the last campaign in enclosure D, which is preserved completely, but also a problem here. The central pillars had been in an oblique position due to slope pressure. So if we would continue to remove the backfilling without doing anything, so that central pillars would fall down. And so we had thinking about how to solve this problem here, just an idea how we did it with some engineering constructions and with simple methods. We brought them back to a vertical position that they can stand by its own, just some idea, some pictures from the work. At first we had to go down to the floor as expected, again, a bedrock floor, again, we will see it later, pedestals cut out of the bedrock, and fortunately the pillars had been really completely preserved without any break, without any damage, so we could do this work, bringing them back to the vertical position. Work done in the last campaign, last spring campaign, here now, the situation with the two pillars, but we recognized one thing, they need to some further construction because the fundamentation was very, very weak. The two pillars in enclosure C had been fundamented quite well, so it was a strong fundamentation. We don't have we don't think about further protection of these pillars, but here now we recognize a very, very weak fundamentation. We are wondering why so weak and why in this way, just to see here this enclosure C with a very solid, very good fundamentation, and now here just a few stones and 15 centimeters down in the bedrock, 15 centimeters. They could do much more without a little effort. No, they decided to do it in this way. Here we have 30, 40 centimeters deepness into the bedrock and a lot of stones around. So we are really wondering why they did it in such a way. Okay, but we will stabilize it by some constructions now and in future. Here now A, B, C, D, the main enclosures in summer 2010 after the consolidation of the two central pillars. And we are now ready in both enclosures in C and D for to be presented to visitors. We have to continue with archaeological work, but the main work is nearly going to its end, and we are thinking about the presentation to visitors, and our architectural department already did some competition about how such a roof shelter could be looking like, and here one example of a shelter, how it could be done to protect the site against rain, against winter, and to give access to visitors to go around, to go inside. Maybe one can add here also some bridges to cross the excavation area. So these are installations which we are preparing now and which hopefully can be realized in near future. What we recognized now on the pillars, so after we excavating them completely, that the arms had fingers. This was no surprise. We expected like this. We knew it from Nevalichori. I showed you this picture again from Nevalichori. But this is the same pillar we saw before, but now completely free from sediments. But there was a surprise. Now, first time we recognized they are wearing belts. They are really anthropomorphic. They have arms, they have fingers, they are wearing belts, and from the belts, loincloths are hanging down. Loincloths quite clearly skins, animal skins, most probably fox skin because of the shape of the tail and the five fingers. So fox skins used as loincloths hanging down from the pillar. So clearly anthropomorphic, but always faceless, without any face depicted. Beings from another world. This looks to be quite clear. It seems to be quite clear as an understanding of this, of the meaning of this strange T-shaped symbols. Yeah, in the case of the eastern one, it's a rock-cut pedestal. We also had some reliefs of birds running from east to west, but only on this pedestal we have such a find so far, not at the other ones. The two central pillars here and the reliefs in this slide, the eastern one, the western one, We see the bells. They are not completely similar here. More decoration, more ornaments on the eastern one, and just an undecorated bell at the western one. But on the inner side, a relief of a bull is visible here at the belt. And this is a pillar who also has some buccranium at its priest, like a pendant hanging around its neck, a buccranium. The other one has a disc and a crescent and a motif we don't understand so far, but both are clearly individualized. They are different beings, and the Stone Age people understood who are these. It's quite clear. And okay, the sex is hidden by the loincloth, so we cannot clearly say it's male or female, but we know from other findings, from other excavations, from figurines wearing belts, that figurines wearing belts usually are male, always are male. So we can be quite sure that both have a male identity if sex was important in any way. But we don't have any female symbols at the site, with one exception: it's a graffiti not belonging to the original decoration. So a spiritual world which is a little bit different what we could expect, for example, when we are coming from Çatalhöyük, when we recognize there's the importance of female symbols in Göbekli Tepe. They are not visible, they are not, I won't say they are not existing, but so far they are not visible. We cannot recognize this aspect of spiritual life. During the excavation of the or the engineering work of the consolidation of the central pillars, we made some interesting discoveries. For example, this stone deliberately placed directly near the pillar in the backfilling. When we excavated it, one face was decorated in this way, a relief, a fragment of another pillar being used here in the filling material. But here now an animal which first time we recognized here on this piece, clearly an hyena recognizable because of this element here at the back of the animal, and also the shape of the head is clearly showing us an hyena is depicted here, and together with a vulture, so we have animals of a specific aspect of the function, eating meat, eating dead corpses. And here we have an isolated human head, which also fits well in this picture, in this explanation, because this part seems to be not the body of this, where this head is belonging to. So it's quite clear it's an isolated head. But it's not surprising. We know from this culture the special treatment of skulls in burials. Skulls are often removed from the body. They are placed somewhere else. They are collected. They are placed in deposits, in pits, or even they had been with some clay. The shape of the face had been given again, like the famous Jericho skulls. So skull cult is known from this culture, so we are not so surprised about the motifs. But we also have sculptures, actual limestone sculptures of humans in life size, or already a little bit in over life size. And again, an interesting finding: these two pieces had been now placed nearly to the western one of the central pillars, to pillar 31. This head was found there, and another one was found here. Life-size heads belonging, quite clear, belonging to sculptures which are showing the complete body. But for the moment, in Göbekli, we have some fragments. There's another one found earlier. But we have, fortunately, the so-called Urfa statue from a site in Şanlıurfa itself of the same period, unfortunately lost due to building activities of the town. But fortunately, one of findings reached the museum in Şanlıurfa, a statue, a life-size statue, and we are quite sure that our heads originally belonged to similar statues, which are so different from the T-shapes. Now, we have to remember this anonymity of the T-shapes, no face, this strange, stylized shape of the body. It was possible to depict it different. So I think we can really go so far. They have clear different meanings. The T-shapes coming from another world, and the statues, the life-size statues, they look like guards, like servants, like guards of the T-shapes, but they are belonging together. They are one group which clearly belongs together. But not only humans had been depicted in sculptures, we saw the high reliefs, this one group, but we really have true sculptures, like this example here, a wild boar, which was placed in the wall of enclosure Z, and we had to remove it to bring it to the museum, so fortunately we could recognize this was really made to be anchored in the wall, in the stone wall of this enclosure, and the head of this boar nearly is life-size. Just this part is lost, but the rest is completely preserved, very well preserved, and nearly life-size head as resonating animal. And again, I would say these are like guards, like the Urfa statue and the other sculptures. They are like guards of these enclosures, guards of the T-shapes. They are in their context, they had been placed in the walls. Another example of such a guarding figure here, an animal, and with an aggressive animal showing its teeth. It was placed here in the second circle of enclosure, see in the wall, and after removing it, bringing it to the museum, we see here the complete body of this animal. And again, as I told you, it's looking like guard. So we can define several types of these animals, these aggressive animals, the wild boars with its big teeth, and the animals showing its teeth, the predators, maybe leopards depicted here. So two groups, sorry, it's going always away, two groups with clearly now identifiable in the depictions of the high reliefs. Another motif, a little bit different now, the leopard motif may be here in some other examples. This one is an in situ example in enclosure. A sea, this one is one of the high reliefs of the portal stone and some other findings. But it's clear we are getting now, we come near to a typology of these depictions, of these motifs, of these garden figurines. Last season, we had a surprise, an unexpected surprise, in an area we didn't want to excavate. It's indicated it here on this map. This is a main excavation area, some extension to the west here. And in this area, one of our workmen recognized that one of the stones visible at the surface had ears. A stone with ears, okay, a fragment of a sculpture. So we had very often such findings. We tried to remove it from the surface, but it was not possible. So we had to excavate down here because we recognized it's not just a fragment, it's part of a quite big a sculpture which is placed here in this part. And yeah, we had to really excavate now 2 meters deep till we excavated a room with walls and pillars and floor and so on, and we excavated this pole-like stick made of limestone. A height of 2 meters had been became visible. The length completely preserved here. The ears are the ears. Unfortunately, two faces of two motifs had been smashed away in antiquity, but the lower part was completely preserved, clearly here showing us a human head, human arms situation, maybe birth giving or phallus presenting, we are not completely sure about the meaning. Another motif here, again with human arms, the head is lost, and a third motif on top here now in the museum, the piece being in the museum, photographed in a different way. So we can, here's the ears which had been visible at the surface, and this is an eye, so we can be very sure that it was not a human being on top of it, but an animal, maybe again a leopard or a lion, but with arms, and these arms are holding now quite probably a human head, because we know this motif from other findings. Animals, wild animals, are human heads, holding human heads. This is a well-known motif from Nevele Çori and from Göbekli Tepe. So, but now here we had a composition, we already expected such pieces from some fragments, but we didn't have a complete one. Now we know it's true. Some findings from Nevele Çori, and she is indicating Nevele Çori, or from Göbekli Tepe, an animal, a dangerous animal holding a human head, or here another piece from Göbekli Tepe, an animal, this part is not preserved, holding a human head, and here from Nevele Çori, a big bird The wings are visible here, upper part is lost, but again holding a human head. This motif was known, but now can be sure. They had been totem pole-like objects made here from limestone. It's clear that we should expect wooden examples too, which are not preserved due to the conditions, to the climatic conditions, but fortunately we have it also in stone. Really a monumental finding, 1.92 meters, the exact dimension of this piece now being in Urfa Museum. Fortunately, we could give some support to the museum to rearrange the exhibition, because until this winter, no findings from Göbekli Tepe and from or very few findings from Göbekli and from Neverli Çori had been in display, had been in the exhibition, and so we could help to find some new showcases and to show some of the findings from the sculptured findings from Göbekli Tepe, and especially the pole is included, and some other you remember the boar and some other boars, and so you see the richness of the findings, which are now since several weeks now visible in the Urfa Museum, which can be visited by any visitor coming there. I cannot show you all the sculptures, all the reliefs and all the elements of the spiritual world and all the architectural elements of this site. We are still on the top of an iceberg in the work in Göbekli Tepe. The site is very huge, and we can expect rich results in future. But one thing is clear, it's an extraordinary site. It's not standing alone. We know sites, we know the settlements, the contemporaneous settlements of the 10th and 9th millennium, due to excavations by international colleagues in Turkey, mainly Turkish and American colleagues, in North Syria, Syrian and French colleagues, sites like Cherf el Ahmar, Tel Karamel, Çadeh, Mureybet in Syria, and in Turkey, Çayuni, Neverli Çori, Demirci, Kırtık Tepe, Halançemi, and new sites in this region, and so on in northern Iraq, Karamestere and Nemri, a little bit far away. But at least this circle of 200 kilometers around Göbekli Tepe, at least in this area, we can expect that the people are belonging to the network, to the cultic community of Göbekli Tepe, to a network of people coming to this central sanctuary of Göbekli Tepe, coming there for big feastings, meeting there for several weeks, maybe months, having these feastings, and now they have the manpower to erect the monumental monuments at this site. Now the manpower is there for several weeks. They can work now in the quarries with the help of the specialists living at the site all over the year, and a function we still are working on it, by what they are really doing in these circles, why they are erecting them, we don't know exactly, but our hypothesis is a basic reason in humanity, burials, burial customs, burial rituals done at this site, burial for important persons, not for everyone of society. This seems to be the reason, because we have already human bones in the fillings, but we didn't uncover so far the burials itself, but we expect these burials behind the walls, inside the benches, the stone benches, where the enclosures had been made from, and we didn't remove such things because such a removing would be a clear destruction of these circles. So we are patient in this case till we will be able to uncover burials, but the prediction is that burials is a burial site. That's the main reason for Göbekli Tepe being in the center of a region. I already call it cultic community of Göbekli Tepe. Lots of sites belonging to it, the settlement of settled hunter-gatherers. It's also a phenomenon which is new. We recognize, me and all the colleagues working in this period are recognizing, that settled down is not an invention of the farmers. It was invented before. They are very effective hunter-gatherers settling in villages, but now they are inventing, this cultic community of Göbekli Tepe is now inventing the new way of life, joining, adding a lot of innovations to a new package, what we call the Neolithic package, which enables these cultures now to this successful, spread over the old world, and this Neolithic package gives an advantage over people who don't have it, and so this new way of life is so successful in the old world. And you remember the green circle from the beginning, the area where the wild species had been existing mainly in Upper Mesopotamia, it's nearly similar with our archaeological circle here done by the excavation. So the people inventing the way of the new way of life, they are the same people coming to Göbekli Tepe and building there what we call the first temples. I have to say the word temple is a little bit problemous because temple means it, an open access during the time, and the temples in Göbekli Tepe had been soon buried completely, so it's a little bit different from temples of later periods, but they are big sanctuaries in any way. They are sanctuaries, they are part of a ritual sphere which is now getting step by step unveiled by the excavations. I come to the final point just to show you the importance of the site also in the public had been which now is existing. So there are several translations of a book I wrote some years ago about this site, about the excavations. Also a Turkish translation is available, and now in this spring an Italian translation is added. There is also a Polish one and a Russian one. And we are doing in Urfa every season now, it's getting a custom, we're doing some conferences, we're doing exhibitions in the town hall of the Belediye, where we can present our yearly results to the public. And we are also present in the media. Dr. Ahmed Fakih Baba already showed you the National Geographic covers the English one, the birth of religion, which is a little bit problemous. It's not the birth, better is the power of religion, because the birth of religion is much earlier in the Paleolithic period in Lascaux and Altamira and all these cases. Maybe we have the birth of religion. Okay, but it's not so important. The power of religion. Unfortunately, the Turkish issue has the Göbekli story included, but not on the cover. But some years ago in Geo, in Turkish Geo, Göbekli already had been as a cover story. And there are many, many other publications in also in periodicals of public interest where this site is mentioned, or this, where it's written about this site, which is getting more and more important. And the German issue, I don't have a picture, is writing The New Stonehenge, and I think it's also a very good title. The New Stonehenge, and we can be sure about the importance of Göbekli Tepe being a new Stonehenge with many, many, many, many visitors coming in future to see this site. And now I'm coming to this slide, and it's time to say thank you. At first to the General Directorate of Antiquities in Ankara to give us a kind permission to work, and this site to say thank you to our representative sent by the ministry, to our Başkan Yardımcı, Docent Dr. Cihat Kürkçüoğlu from the Harran University, who is working with us at the site, and to all the specialists, the scientific specialists, and the students, and the workmen from the nearby village of Örencik, who enable us year by year to continue with the work and to have these results I tried to present you. Thank you for your patience.
Klaus Schmidt, çok çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Thank you very much, Herr Schmidt. We can have a few questions if you want to. We can have a few questions. Sorularımız varsa eğer alabilir kendisi. Arkadaşlarımız iletecek sizlere mikrofonu.
I have seen the documentary.
Yeah, okay. Please.
I've seen the documentary. I've seen the documentary by Ahmet Yazman. Mm-hmm. And I've seen the figurine, Şanlıurfa sculpture.
Yeah.
And this, the very same week, I came across with the intelligence magazine of The Economist. And there was an article on Australia, Kimberley, which is the west, northwest of Australia, mm-hmm. and the same figurines in the cave paintings of Australia. Is there any study going on between these two, the same date also,
as
12th century before?
As we don't have results of such comparative studies, but we are preparing, we are on the way to organize groups of specialists, not only from archaeology, but from a wider sphere of specialists dealing with these spiritual expressions of humanity to understand such similarities which are existing, but there are no results for the moment. But Homo sapiens, the humans, we know we are all from one family, from one tribe. Homo sapiens always find similar ideas. So the spiritual world of all humans is very often very close to each other. So we are not inventing so many different things. We are following a common trail on such things. But okay, detailed studies are not ready for the moment.
And they don't have the mouth. Is there a...
No face.
No, the eyes, nose, but no mouth.
The statues.
Statues, yeah, and also the cave paintings. They don't have the mouth.
This could indicate that there are, maybe for example, they are guarding, but they are not telling something about what's going on. So they will not tell you what's going on in these circles. This could be an explanation, but just one of other ones. So we have to collect observations. We are still at the point to collect the observations for a final understanding. It's too early of these things.
Thank you.
Hello. My name is Beyhan Türer. I'm an architect, retired architect. And I congratulate you for your curiosity and for your scientific knowledge. I think that you did a great job, and I'm sure that it will be appreciated for more people. But I was wondering, how come that for 10,000 years, Göbekli Tepe wasn't recognized, find anything until 1994, when a shepherd was curious, like you are, so discovered that. What's your opinion on that?
The shepherd didn't discover the site. He knew about this strange site, but the discovery was made by the Harley Chamber Robert Braidwood survey in 63. And this report, it's published report, published in 80. This report was, for me, the reason to look for the site, to go there. The shepherd, he understood this is a special site, but he didn't go further, so he didn't tell anyone about it. But he was, for me, helpful to find this site. In this way, the story is true. But yeah, we are wondering why such a site had been unrecognized so long. We understand now southeastern Turkey has a lot of surprises. So I think we are still at the beginning. So we have the survey works mainly done in the dam areas of the Tigris and Euphrates and other rivers, dam constructions. So we know about the sites in the valleys, in the plains, but we don't know about the sites between the valleys of the rivers. And Göbekli Tepe is on top of a mountain. So I'm sure we will have some surprises in future when continuing with research, especially in southeastern Turkey, with a lot of important sites undiscovered so far.
I hope you will have a long life and discover some more.
Not only for me, but there are a lot of many, many colleagues, younger colleagues especially, who have their chance.
On the screen, sorry?
In southeastern Turkey, we have so many isolated trees, huge trees, and these are recognized as ritual sites. for the people living in close vicinity. Have you been able to detect any continuation of this? I mean, these people living there in 1,000 millenniums back left all of a sudden. And from that time to our present time.
Yeah. No, I wouldn't expect it, because the space, the amount so of time is so long. So, and we don't have any continuation of the symbolic world of Göbekli Tepe and this time, this region, till the 7th millennium, for example. It's completely lost. We don't have any traces later. So I think there is, we can say no, there is not a continuation. It cannot be, because we even don't have a continuation into the cultures of the ancient Orient, of the, like Sumer and the Akkadian and so on. So we don't have any traces of this symbolic world anymore. So it's lost. It's a lost world, which is now coming to light step by step.
So you haven't discovered anything related to a couple of thousand years back?
No,
nothing.
Nothing between. Just a Roman watchtower on the southern plateau, but it was military reasons. But nothing which is showing a continuity of the spiritual life which had been happening in Göbekli Tepe.
I can ask a second question. Çatalhöyük abandoned, if I am right, because of the eruption of two major volcanic mountains in the vicinity, if I am right. Now here, abandoning this site, possibly due to Karacadağ, if the time gap, I have no idea.
It's a volcanic event.
Yeah, Karacadağ.
Yeah,
could it be the reason why people all of a sudden left?
But we have also in the archaeological record, we have this observation of a reduction, of a clear reduction. The monumentality is disappearing. 10, 12 monumental pillars in one enclosure. Later, 6 pillars, 4 pillars, 2 pillars, 1 pillar is left, and it's getting smaller and smaller and smaller, going to its end. So it's looking more like a natural development. The spiritual world is getting unimportant. The people find new expressions of their religious thinkings and their religious beliefs. They are changing the places. They are now settling in the valleys. They are now being farmers, not anymore hunter-gatherers. So I think we don't need a volcano to explain the end of Göbekli Tepe.
Thanks, sir.
Between those T-shaped pillars, I saw something like masonry, the walls. Were they attached each other with walls? I mean, I saw some stone walls, like masonry. Were they attached, those T-shaped pillars? Were they attached each other with a kind of wall? Or what I saw were just the rubble under which the site was buried?
I'm not sure if I understood you well, but the pillars of the circle are always connected by walls. They are inset in the walls.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
the central ones are freestanding ones, fundamentally in a very different way.
Yes, the round ones, between the round ones, I mean, I saw something like masonry.
I don't know.
Wall pieces, masonry.
Masonry, walls, yes, wall, sure, yes.
Were they attached to each other?
Yeah, they are.
The
wall? Yes, there are the walls and the pillars are built together. So, this,
okay, thank you.
In the circle, but not in the center.
Yes, in the circle. Yeah. I thought maybe they would.
Sorry,
they would be
Maybe I missed to explain it more in detail.
I thought maybe they were just the rubble under which the site was buried,
No.
Thank you.
The walls are holding the pillars in the circle.
Ben Betül Arım. Ses geliyor mu? Tiyatro oyuncusuyum. Aynı zamanda yaşama sanatı öğretmeniyim. Ben şimdi sesli düşünmek istiyorum. Bunu seyrederken benim bir jeoloji mühendisi arkadaşım var. Aynı zamanda radyastezi uzmanı. Ve bir arsa veriliyor. Amerika'da olsun, isterse Antarktika'da olsun. Ona haritayı gönderiyorlar. Arsanın yerini ya da evinizin şeklini çiziyorsunuz. O yer altında ne olduğunu, kaç santimde petrol mü, taş mı, hangi taş olduğunu her şeyi biliyor. Şimdi bazı medyumlar var. Onlar da biliyorlar pek çok şeyi. Acaba diyorum ki buradaki çıkan şeylerin geçmişte ne oldu, neler yaşandı, neden onların yapıldığı hakkında böyle bir şeyden yararlanabilir mi? Yani onlar da gelip burada aynen halk gibi, arkeologlar gibi bir böyle bir şey olabilir mi? Sesli düşünüyorum. Teşekkür ederim. Emeğiniz için çok çok teşekkür ediyorum. Evet. Sağ olun, var olun. İyi ki varsınız.
I wouldn't exclude such possibilities that we can get help from other side to understand the observations, but this ideas always will be very individual ideas. So I think they will be not getting accepted by the wider audience. So this will be the problem with such things. So the way of excavating such sites is like a detective, like a criminalist, to collect observations and to work with the observations we can find in the earth, which we can find in the iconography, we can find in the remains of the plant remains, the animal remains, and so on. But I would say it's clearly very fascinating and interesting to have other ideas about these things. But they can be only additive. They can be not in the core of the reconstruction of the past.
Son sorumuzu alacağız. It's going to be the last question from here.
Spiritual sites in many civilizations are also material places where there is lots of accumulation, food storage, other wealth accumulating. Is there any sign of such accumulation at Göbekli?
Yes, not in Göbekli Tepe, but in the settlements of the region around. We have food storage, for example, in a large scale. It's a part of the daily life of these hunter-gathering societies. They are storing. They have very effective hunting strategies. So, or they are collecting wild cereals in a very intensive way, and they are storing this food surplus. But not in Göbekli Tepe. They are coming maybe with their food. They are coming to the site, having these feasting there, staying there for several weeks, and doing the construction work. So what you are asking for is, we know it, it's existent in the settlements.
And there's a connection.
They have connections, yeah. So it's really a siaret. It's a site where the people are coming for specific reasons, but they're going back to the settlements. In the settlements, we have these storage facilities. So we can be so sure, because we know the type of houses of storage in the villages, and such buildings we don't have in Göbekli Tepe. So it's completely different. But contemporaneous, you know.
Çok teşekkürler, yeah. Professor Klaus Schmidt. Thank you very much.
Değerli konuklarımız, katıldığınız için çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Mimarlığın Kökenleri konferans dizisinin ikincisi 5 Eylül tarihinde.